Good morning, students. So today's class is on the spotters which we give in the topic antimicrobials. So I think there are a total of 6 or 7 drugs. So we will go one by one about each drug. Then the last drug will be a homework for you again, just like last week. Just work it out and then send me the picture of the answers. The first drug is metronidazole. So what is metronidazole? See, generally when you're getting these drugs as spotters, common questions will be which class this drug belongs to, or what is the mechanism of action, then uses and adverse effects, two uses, two adverse effects, and then name another drug of the same group. So these are the common questions which might repeat for all of these drugs. So any other specific important point is there about the drug, that also can come as a single 1 mark, half mark. So each spotter, it accounts for half mark. So if there is any specific important point regarding that drug, then you can get that. So metronidazole belongs to which group of drugs? So metronidazole is an anti-amoebic drug. Is it a tissue or luminal amoebicide? So it is a tissue amoebicide. Then write the uses of metronidazole. So if you see the question below, all these are the conditions where metronidazole can be used. Intestinal amoebiasis, amoebic dysentery, giardiasis, trichomonas vaginitis, pseudomembranous colitis. So all these are the conditions where metronidazole can be used. So you can take any two of these uses and you can write the two uses of metronidazole. Then just go through the textbook about the doses, write the, you won't get all these in a single question. So I just grouped them in a single question. So they will ask you what is the dose of metronidazole in intestinal amoebiasis, or what is the dose in amoebic dysentery or giardiasis or trichomonas vaginitis. So just go through the doses. Important amongst these will are intestinal amoebiasis and amoebic dysentery and pseudomembranous colitis. Giardiasis and trichomonas vaginitis, you may not get that for spotters. So just go through the doses of intestinal amoebiasis, amoebic dysentery and pseudomembranous colitis. Then write two adverse effects. So mostly these will be GIT adverse effects, nausea, vomiting, epigastric distress and all. Then there is a specific reaction with alcohol that will come in an interaction. The next, name two congeners of metronidazole. So apart from metronidazole, what are the other drugs that can come in this group? Like tinidazole, secnidazole, onidazole. Okay. So you can write two other names apart from metronidazole. Then give a name for the reaction that can occur between metronidazole and alcohol. See, if you know the metabolism of alcohol, alcohol is metabolized by alcohol dehydrogenase to acetaldehyde. Then acetaldehyde dehydrogenase acts on acetaldehyde and acetaldehyde is metabolized to acetic acid. So now what happens whenever you have alcohol, you may have the pleasant effects when you have it, but then the next day morning you will be having a hangover. So if you give a drug, there is a drug named disulfiram. So if you give the drug, so what does it do? It inhibits the acetaldehyde dehydrogenase enzyme, then leading to the accumulation of acetaldehyde in the body. So that results in production of symptoms which are similar to your hangover symptoms. So the person, he will develop aversion for drinking alcohol. So this disulfiram, it is used to decrease the addiction for alcohol. Okay, so that disulfiram also has another name, antabuse. Okay, so now there are certain drugs which when given, they interact, they produce a disulfiram type of reaction in the body. See, metronidazole is one such drug. Metronidazole acts by inhibiting acetaldehyde dehydrogenase enzyme. So then there is accumulation of acetaldehyde in the body leading to a disulfiram type reaction. Okay. So give a name for reaction that can occur between metronidazole and alcohol, that is disulfiram reaction. Why does metronidazole increase lithium toxicity? See, these two questions, the last two questions, they are just, they have the same reason, but these are the two different forms in which the question can be framed. So metronidazole decreases the renal excretion of lithium and warfarin. So what happens? So there is lithium accumulation or warfarin accumulation in the body, leading to increased toxicity. So metronidazole increases lithium toxicity. Then the other one is warfarin dose should be increased or decreased. The reason is the same. So this is another way in which the question can be framed. So warfarin dose should be decreased because there is accumulation of warfarin in the body. So you need to decrease the warfarin dose when you're giving it along with metronidazole. So these are the questions about metronidazole. Coming to the next drug, acyclovir. So what is acyclovir? So I hope you know what acyclovir is. It belongs to which group of drugs? It is an antiviral drug. Then write the mechanism of action of acyclovir. So what is the mechanism of action? First, acyclovir is converted to acyclovir monophosphate by viral thymidine kinase enzyme. Viral thymidine kinase enzyme, it converts acyclovir to acyclovir monophosphate. Then again, the host kinase enzymes act and convert it into the diphosphate and triphosphate forms. So that is this triphosphate, this active triphosphate form of acyclovir, which is formed, this inhibits the viral DNA polymerase enzyme, okay, and decreases the viral replication. So this much you need not write. So what you write here, because it's a half mark question. So what is the mechanism of action? Acyclovir is converted to its active triphosphate form, which inhibits the viral DNA polymerase and decreases viral replication. So that will be for your half mark. That much is enough. If it is like a 2 marks question or a 4 marks question, there you need to explain in detail. So give two reasons for selective toxicity. So why is it not affecting the host DNA polymerase, and why it's affecting only the viral DNA polymerase? And why is it affecting only the virus without affecting the host cells? So one reason for this is it gets phosphorylated to its active form only in the parasite infected cells. So it does not affect the healthy host cells. It affects only the parasite infected host cells, and this is more, it has more affinity, more, it inhibits more the viral DNA polymerase rather than the host DNA polymerase. So these are the two reasons for selective toxicity. Then give two resistance mechanisms. See, I have explained the mechanism of action. Viral thymidine kinase, this converts acyclovir to acyclovir monophosphate. So one resistance mechanism will be, there will be a mutation and there will be a altered viral thymidine kinase which cannot convert the acyclovir to acyclovir monophosphate. So one mechanism for development of resistance. Then the other one will be the viral DNA polymerase, it develops decreased affinity for acyclovir triphosphate form, the active form of acyclovir. There is decreased affinity for viral DNA polymerase. So these two resistance mechanisms you can write. Then we'll write the antiviral spectrum of acyclovir. So mainly it is used for herpes simplex virus infections, HSV 1 and 2. And also the other important one is cytomegalovirus. Okay. Sorry, herpes zoster virus. So HSV, VZV, and little affinity for, the other one is not that important. So this much is enough. Antiviral spectrum, HSV 1 and 2 and VZV. The same thing you can write for what right to uses of acyclovir. That will be again herpes simplex virus and varicella zoster virus infections. What is the dose of acyclovir? Then 400 mg TDS or 200 mg 4 to 5 times a day is the dose of acyclovir. So this is about acyclovir. Coming to the next drug, albendazole. Albendazole is an anti-helminthic drug. It is a broad spectrum anti-helminthic drug. So usually it covers all the helminths, most of the helminths. Just that there is a dose variation. For some helminths, less the dose is enough. For others, a little higher dose is needed. So with the dose variation, otherwise it covers all the helminths. So it's a broad spectrum anti-helminthic drug. It belongs to the it is an anti-helminthic drug. Then write the uses of albendazole. So if you know the anti-helminthic spectrum of albendazole, so amongst them you can select two infections and then you can mention them as uses of albendazole. So what is the anti-helminthic spectrum? So all the helminths, Ascaris lumbricoides, Necator americanus, then Ankylosed stromatodinale, Trichuris trichura, then Entrobius vermicularis, Strongyloid stercularis, all these. So all the helminths it covers. So that is the antihelminthic spectrum, and amongst them you can select two uses and write. Then the other is, what is the mechanism of action of benzimidazole? See, this benzimidazole, it includes albendazole, thiabendazole, mebendazole, okay, not metronidazole. See, that's spelled similar, but metronidazole is an anti-amoebic drug. Albendazole, mebendazole, thiabendazole, these come under the benzimidazole group, and these are antihelminthics. Metronidazole is an anti-amoebic drug. So what is the mechanism of action here? See, these helminths, in their cytoskeletal structure, we have microtubules and microfilaments. So the basic unit for these microtubules or microfilaments is beta tubulin. So what happens, this beta tubulin, it keeps polymerizing and depolymerizing, and that helps in the formation of microtubules and microfilaments. Now this albendazole, this binds to the beta tubulin and prevents the polymerization of beta tubulin, so affecting the cytoskeletal structure of the helminth. So the helminth dies. So that is the mechanism of action. Then what is the dose? See, the doses, here I've just written cutaneous lava migrans and for cysticercosis and hydatid disease. But try to remember the doses for all the other infections. Each single infection can come as a single question. So what is the dose for Trichuris trichura, then Ankylosed stromatodinale, Ascaris lumbricoides? For all these three infections, it is a single dose. Then again, for Strongyloid stercularis, it's a different dose. Then Entrobius vermicularis, it's a different dose. So try to read all the doses for each infection. Okay, each one can come as a single question. Then write two adverse effects. You can refer and write the adverse effects. I think mostly alopecia occurs, and there are, again, GIT symptoms will be there. Okay, then write another drug of the same group. So thiabendazole, mebendazole. So these are the other drugs of the same group. So that is about albendazole. So it's a broad spectrum antihelminthic drug. Then coming to fluconazole. Fluconazole is an antifungal drug. So this belongs to, again, which group? It is an antifungal drug. Mechanism of action is, it inhibits 14 alpha demethylase enzyme. So this enzyme, this particular enzyme, is necessary for the formation of ergosterol, fungal ergosterol. So that form, this ergosterol is necessary for the formation of the fungal cell membrane. So what does this fluconazole do? This inhibits the 14 alpha demethylase enzyme, inhibits the ergosterol formation, and then the fungal cell wall becomes leaky. So then the fungus, it dies. So that is the mechanism of action. Then mention two uses of fluconazole. So fluconazole, it can be used for candidiasis, then meningeal cryptococcosis, mostly for candidiasis, then meningeal cryptococcosis and meningeal coccidiomycosis, you can use fluconazole. Then write two adverse effects, just refer them. Do proton pump inhibitors and H2 blockers decrease the absorption of fluconazole? See, this azole group of drugs like itraconazole, ketoconazole, these two, they are dependent on acidic pH. They need an acidic pH for absorption. Whereas fluconazole, its absorption is not dependent on acidic pH. There is no need for an acidic pH. So this question is very important. See, proton pump inhibitors and H2 blockers, they decrease the pH in the stomach. So when that happens, ketoconazole and itraconazole, they cannot be absorbed because they need an acidic pH. Whereas fluconazole, it does not need an acidic pH. So when they are given, even though the gastric pH decreases, it does not affect the absorption of fluconazole. Okay. Then what is the dose of fluconazole? 150 to 400 mg once daily is the dose. So this is about fluconazole. It's an antifungal drug. Coming to the next drug, chloroquine. See, chloroquine is an anti-malarial drug. Okay, then is chloroquine is effective against which plasmodial state of the malarial parasite? See, it does not have an effect on the hepatic schizons. It acts mainly on the blood schizons. Okay, so it is a fast-acting blood schizonticide. Okay, this it acts very fastly and it affects only the schizons which are there in the red blood cells. Okay, but it has no effect on the hepatic schizons. Then this also affects the gametocytes of Plasmodium vivax and Nobel, but not malaria. So that is the spectrum of chloroquine. Then what is the dose of chloroquine in chemoprophylaxis? Chloroquine is very important. So the doses you need to remember for prophylaxis. So whenever you're going to a malaria endemic region, so endemic means that in that particular place, malaria is there forever. Okay, the people who are living there, they keep getting, because the mosquitoes are very prevalent there, and malaria is almost present all the time in that particular place. So that we call it as an endemic. So if you're going to a malaria endemic region, so how do you need to take? You need to take chloroquine in a prophylactic dose. So that will be 600 mg first dose the day when you're starting, and again 600 mg on the last day when you're leaving that place. In between, it will be 300 mg weekly. Then again, at the end, you need to take 0.5 mg per kg primaquine. Okay, so 600 mg on the first day and last day, 300 mg weekly in between, followed at the end by 0.5 mg per kg primaquine. Then what is the dose of chloroquine in clinical cure? So here you need to give a 600 mg start dose, a start loading dose of 600 mg followed by 300 mg after 8 hours. That is on the first day. So you give 600 mg start dose followed by 300 mg after 8 hours on the first day. Then 300 mg daily following next 2 days. So that is the dose of chloroquine for clinical cure. Then what are the different routes in which chloroquine can be administered? Chloroquine can be administered orally or IM or by IV infusion. What is the mechanism of action of chloroquine? See, chloroquine, first it gets accumulated in the parasite infested RBCs. First it enters the RBCs. From there, it enters the parasite food vacuoles of the parasite. So what does it do there? It inhibits the peptide bond formation and decreases the amino acid synthesis, and so the parasite, it cannot survive. So that is the mechanism of action of chloroquine. Right to uses, so as I've said, you can write it is used in chemoprophylaxis of malaria and also for clinical cure of malaria. Then two non-malarial uses of chloroquine, you can use it in rheumatoid arthritis and amoebic axis. Then mention two adverse effects of chloroquine. See, this you can refer, mostly get GI symptoms, and then it affects the eyes, retina and visual field abnormalities. Mention two contraindications of chloroquine. See, as it affects the eyes, if you already have a retinal problem, do not prescribe chloroquine. Or in G6PD deficient individuals, it leads to hemolytic anemia. And so contraindicated in people with G6PD deficiency. And in porphyria and in psoriasis, it is again contraindicated because it will aggravate the condition. This is about chloroquine. See, this last drug, so I need you to work on it. So read the questions. If you know the answers, you can write without referring, or if you don't know, refer, write the answers, do this homework, and submit the PDF for me through WhatsApp. So what are the questions? Amoxicillin plus clavulanic acid, this comes with a trade name Augmentin. Okay. So what are the questions here? Amoxicillin belongs to which group of antimicrobials? Then what is the mechanism of action of amoxicillin? Name two aromatic rings present in the structure of amoxicillin. What is the mechanism of action of clavulanic acid? Then mention one advantage of this combination. Name two other penicillins that are sensitive to beta-lactamase degradation. See, this you can answer if you see the classification of penicillins, okay? So in Sharma, if you refer the classification of penicillins, so the last question you can answer. Name two other penicillins that are sensitive to beta-lactamase degradation apart from amoxicillin, okay? Then name two aminopenicillins other than amoxicillin. Name two other such fixed dose combinations like amoxicillin and clavulanic acid. So name two other such fixed dose combinations. Then what are the other two drugs apart from amoxicillin in the triple therapy of H. pylori infection. So in H. pylori infection, we have regimes. Okay. So in that triple therapy, what are the other two drugs apart from amoxicillin? They're mentioned to adverse effects of penicillins. Okay. So refer all these questions. Do your homework and submit to me by tomorrow. Okay. Send them through WhatsApp. Okay. Just go through the video again. Just go through all these questions once again. So these are the drugs which come as squatters in antimicrobials chapter. So the previous class, I taught you the squatters regarding hormones and then antimicrobials. So if you want to revise, just go through these videos again and be thorough with all the questions that can come in your squatters exam. Thank you.